Well, now, that didn't take long, did it? Only 2 weeks of the football championship, yet there are 12 counties left. Most of them are gone, some of the big counties continuing to fall. And we're going to see how that came about in the company of Ciarán Whelan and Tomás O'Shea. Try to smile, Tomás. Later, we're going to see how the hurling and camogie championships unfolded with Ursula Jacob and Donal O'Cusack. But of course, it was football that took centre stage this weekend. So let's start with the big Munster football semi-final, where a young Cork side took on the hot favourites and provincial champions Kerry. Commentary here comes from Kevin McStay and Ger Canning.
Cork versus Kerry. A matter of perspective. Munster's old firm. Or the most one-sided rivalry in the game.
Kerry are ripping them apart in defence.
A golden generation ready to come of age. Another kingdom canter.
Kerry have retained the Munster Championship.
Don't be so sure. These rebels may be resurgent.
Cork approached this Munster semi-final with four championship newcomers. Maurice Shanley at full-back and Sean Meehan at number six. While among the forwards is Colm O'Callaghan, and in a late change, Paul Walsh is starting in place of Luke Connolly. Provincial champions Kerry have one new man to championship fare. That's Ronan Buckley at left wing forward. While on the opposite flank, Brian O'Biagli gets the nod ahead of Stephen O'Brien. For a Kerry side, pleased to welcome back Peter Crowley, who missed last year to injury. And it's Cork who won the toss, and they're going to play from right to left in the first half on what is a very, very wet afternoon. And this is a good move forward here by Brian O'Biagli. O'Biagli has a support player. It's a very good stop by Micheál Martin. Point blank range, comes back out here to Ronan Buckley, and Kerry will be happy to get a point at the end of all of that. It might well have been a goal, the opening goal of the match.
And he had goal in his mind, but Micheál Martin was equal to it. A very fine save. But a score on the follow-up, of course.
Here's Colm O'Callaghan. First time, I think, to get his hands on the ball in this match. In as far as Powter. Powter kicking from outside the 20-metre line, showing he's not just a wonderful tackler, he's also a very, very astute forward, and gets his first point in the championship here. It's 3 points apiece, and the teams are level once again for the third time. Here's Peter Clifford. Peter Crowley, delighted to be back in the action again. Nicely in as far as Moynihan. Shielded it very well with his body. Controls it, kicks from 20 metres, and he's got a score out of it. Good work indeed by Dara Moynihan. Just his second ever championship point, and he's put Kerry back in front again. One additional minute will be played at the end of the opening 35. Into the hands of Ian Maguire, the team captain, and the 26-year-old storms forward here, ready to free it inside. Kicked there by Kevin O'Donovan, and O'Donovan under pressure kicks it over the bar. What a time to get your first championship score. And it's Kevin O'Donovan of Nemo Rangers who has done it. And Cork, in stoppage time, lead the match here by 6-5. Brian O'Biagli, who had a goal chance in the first half. Best goal chance we saw. Sails in over the head of Clifford. Dangerous situation, gets the ball back. Oh! That has gone wide. How did he miss? He can't believe it. Look at the rain. Thought last week was bad. This is pretty hectic as well. And it's going to be a free in for Cork for a foul on Ian Maguire just outside the D. And Cork have an opportunity of taking the lead again. Impossible conditions, you would have to say. Mid-November, this is the championship of 2020. Killian O'Hanlon, who kicked 145 earlier on, approaching this one now, looking for the perfect connection. He does just that, and it gets up and over the Kerry crossbar, and a second point for Killian O'Hanlon, the 27-year-old who's made it Cork 7, Kerry 6 in this Munster semi-final, where there is a place at stake in the final in 2 weeks' time against the Premier County from Tipperary. It's still Spillane, dangerous, and he fists it up and over the bar, and he's got the equalising score here, doing exactly what was expected of him when he came on as a substitute, getting the teams back level once again, level for the sixth time. back as far as Jason Foley from Paul Murphy. David Moran. An opportunity now to kick for Killian Spillane, kicking with confidence, with accuracy, and he's got a second point since coming on, making his mark, making it 10-8. This has to be it. Cork have got to try and get a shot on target, and they've got to try and make it count, otherwise they're out of the championship and Kerry are in the Munster final. And whoever wins the Munster final will be in the All-Ireland semi this year, no quarters. Powter well blocked down, brilliantly blocked down that time by Paul Murphy, but Powter has it back again, and a foul committed by Gavin White, free into Cork, chance to level the match and take it into extra time. And the man who's going to take this is going to be Mark Collins. And he's scored a point here to take this match probably into extra time. It just inside the right hand upright. Level 8 times. Waiting now for the referee's whistle at the end of 73 minutes. And the teams will have to keep on playing to resolve this one here. So it ends here after 70 plus minutes, 10 points apiece, and it goes on and on. Jason Foley. Foley down towards Clifford, who moved across where he goes. Maurice Shanley's after him. Clifford fancying his chances up into the air. It's a real hit and hope one. If that makes it, it is some score. It's an astonishing kick by the one man down there who really can produce the magic, David Clifford, with his fourth point. Just watch this, up into the air. It's a sensational score. David Moran. Passes are precise, accurate. No room for errors. Good movement, really good movement. And that one just ran away there. And in the end, kicked over the bar, and there's another one. And it's once again, Killian Spillane, a fourth for him.
Loose ball just flying around off feet and tired legs. And Spillane stayed alert and tidied up and got the score.
13 points to 11. Out here as far as Mark Collins. Inside the 45 to Kerrigan, who held on well. Collins once again. Cork free kick, but it's very near the sideline here. Nearly 6 minutes of the second period of extra time has gone. Four to go. Cork need to make this count. Here's Connolly sending it up, sending it over. It's a magnificent kick by Luke Connolly. His third of the day. Didn't start the match. He's finishing it, and it's now a one-point game. It's Cork 12, Kerry 13. Cork looking to try and get a shot on the target. Here it comes, here it comes. It's Sean Meehan inside here, an opportunity maybe. Back to Meehan again, all the way back towards Luke Connolly. Connolly kicking up into the air. It's drifting, it's moving, it's still in play. It bounces, it's a goal! It's a goal for Cork! That is amazing! It's the man who came to play, Mark Keane, the man from the AFL, the Mitchelstown player, the Collingwood player. He boots it into the back of the net. It's 1983 all over again. Tyke Murphy then, Mark Keane now, and Kerry are out of the championship, and Cork have beaten Kerry. And they go through to play Tipperary in the final. Cork, one goal and 12 points. Kerry, 13 points.
You know, we'll just have to look at ourselves, really, you know, that we had plenty of opportunities and just didn't put them away. And ball retention maybe a bit towards the end. But look, that's just something we just have to go and learn from.
Implemented the game plan, we were in it all the way. We got a bit of luck at the end, and fair play to Mark Keane. And look, we're delighted. You don't always get what you deserve in this game, and they got it today.
Yeah, heck of a win for Cork. Reflected in the smile of Ronan McCarthy there. Kieran, in your wildest dreams, did you see Cork winning today?
No, I don't think not many people did, Des, but people felt they might hang in there, and that's exactly what they did. This was a war of attrition. It was a game played between the two 45s. I think there was 45 frees dead. The conditions were horrific. The way Kerry played probably let Cork stay in the game. But like Des, we've sat here for, I suppose, 7-8 years, and Cork have been described as gutless, spineless, no heart. They've been through horrific times as a county team. Tomorrow they'll walk 2 foot taller. They mightn't win the All-Ireland, but you know what? It's a huge boost for football in Cork. They hung in there. They hung in there right throughout the game. Kerry, you know, looked like they were going to put them away at times, but you have to hand it them in terms of their spirit, their heart and their determination. To be honest, they just wanted it more. They won more dirty ball in that middle third and they kicked crucial frees. Like, they weren't... Kerry, when you look at it, had, I think, 10 scores in play. Cork had 4. But when they got their opportunities, they took them.
It was great for Cork. But what about Kerry? Kerry weren't great today, Tomás.
No, Des. Let's be straight about it. It was a terrible game of football. OK, it was... We'd give out about certain defensive stuff that we'd see up the country or whatnot, but that was a terrible game of football.
Cork, in fairness, said
I know.
I'll come to Kerry.
But it was a hard watch, and like conditions were very, very tough. But when you see at the very, very start of a game Stephen O'Brien being changed and Breon O'Begley being brought in, and Kerry setting up as defensively as they did, I think they got it totally and utterly wrong. I thought it was shambolic from the word go. I thought it was as poor a display as I've seen for Kerry since even 2001, when they lost heavily to Meath. I think the strong points, they played Monaghan, they played Donegal, and we were raving about how direct they were, about the shape they had, the more defensive they were. I think they set up with pure fear today. I think they set up too defensively. I think they didn't go at Cork. I think they stood off Cork. I think coming down today, you'd say the one thing you'd hope, that always hope, that no matter what else, Kerry or the Kerry team would be in a mentally strong place to really go to war with Cork. That's a given. That wasn't there today. You had a couple of highlights, Killian Spillane. But, you know, and it's a question that's going to be thrown at management. Why did they... I just thought, like, why do we... They brought on... The subs they brought on, Des, were all kind of defensive. They brought on Killian Spillane. He went very well. At no stage during the... At half-time that they would change up and go full-on and go manic pressing the way they have been up to now. I just thought it was, on the sideline and on the field, shocking from Kerry. And from a Cork point of view, I've given them grief over the years. They did it as manfully. They set up defensively because of the danger that Kerry had up front. That danger wasn't there today. They were so sloppy today, Kerry were. But Cork set up a certain way, and they stuck to it. They outfought around the middle of the park. They won breaks around the middle of the park. They set up a wall. Why did Kerry have to go this way? Kerry couldn't get through that wall in the middle of the field.
You're going to illustrate that, Kieran, the determination.
I think they knew, Des, how Kerry were going to set up. They'd done it against Monaghan, they'd done it against Donegal. They dropped deeper, like a lot of the way teams are playing. But I thought Cork, they put in Paul Walsh as a third midfielder. And I thought they went long on 22 of their 23 kickouts. They set out their stall, Des, at the start, that they were going to compete in that middle sector. And that's where Kerry brought in a lot of their subs. And it was back to old traditional, raw, intense football, because the conditions were horrific and they picked up breaks. Powder was brilliant at picking up breaks. And as I said, they hung in there. And this phase of play, now Sean Powder kicks that, they held possession for 2 minutes and 22 seconds at the end of normal time to try and force a free. Gavin White comes in over the top. And Mark Collins, it's tight, but it gets over the bar. That brings them, you know, to extra time. But it was generally their work rate. I thought Sean Meehan was excellent at centre-back. Killian O'Hanlon and Ian Maguire in the middle of the park fought really hard. Rory Dean came into it when they went off. And they just got bodies back. And they kind of, in some ways, they mirrored what Kerry were going to do. Kerry were going to drop deeper. And that, for me, is what kept them in the game. But they brought in this guy, Luke Connolly, and you know what a score in such bad conditions off the outside of the boot. You know, 12-10 down, long free, that keeps them just in there. 12, and then they're 2 points down again, free out from under the stand, great kick. So they were always just on Kerry's coattails, and you felt that Kerry were going to pull away an extra time. But that for me, you know, that middle sector was where I think Cork won the game. I agree with Tomás, it was an awful game. And I agree with everything you said. Kerry, it was a really, really poor Kerry performance. But, you know, they were like a boxer that hung in there and it was a snatch and grab and they got it.
Kerry should have put them away, you felt?
They should have, Des. And even as poorly as they played, and if they had the match over again, they'd do it differently. but they were just sloppy from the word go. You know, I just thought it reached, this was a, in fairness, it was a good save. Breena Begley, possibly, this is one of our defenders. If we had more attacking players, we might have had players in there. This was absolute stupid. Four Cork lads inside, a big high ball in, no need at all, at all. Here we have Shane Ryan coming out of goal, and it just happened so many times. The thing that angered me most was there was no change. There didn't seem to be a change or a direct way of actually going about it. We were kicking aimlessly. The shot taking was poor. We were running down dead ends, constantly running down the middle, not keeping it wide enough. How many times did fellas carry ball into contact? Exactly what Cork wanted. Here we have Dermot O'Connor. He tried hard, but look, this should be a simple score over the bar. Even one or two of them, I think, would have just deflated Cork. They left Cork hanging there constantly. And it wasn't as if Cork, this was David Clifford. Clifford missed two. Shawnee Shea missed a couple. It wasn't as if Cork were hurting us on the scoreboard. It wasn't like that at all. You know, and another thing, Des, you know, I suppose Peter Keane here, I mean, made a big decision at the start of the year getting rid of Donny Buckley. And this now is ammunition for people to say, did they sort out their defensive issues? No, they didn't. The first time there was a wall put in front of, what did they think, like, that they were going to go down to Cork and Cork fellas were going to watch them play football?
Were they complacent?
It reeked of that. I think there's plenty of blame to go around in terms of management, and it was just...
I don't think they played to their strengths. I think Kerry, you know, obviously it's a day, not a footballing day for a long kick pass, and it was a day for probably working it through the hand, but they have great forwards. They didn't play Ronan, with shape. They sat back and invited Cork. Gave Cork plenty of possession.
And you have to give Ronan and Kieran a touch, and Ronan McCarthy, Keane O'Neill, the management, the younger players that came into there, they played with...
Brilliant.
They were fearless. Luke Connolly was outstanding. Powter was outstanding. Midfield, just that utter work rate
Let's see the reward they got. They had to hang in, like, time was up. And this goal came.
And again, it was very similar.
1983 for the younger people.
Into the same goal, Tighe Murphy.
It was like the end of normal time. And I was talking to Moss at the time, and he was actually saying, get it to Luke Connolly because he's liable to have a shot because Kerry were closing them down. And, you know, you have here, you have on the edge of the square, you have Keane and you have Tommy Walsh actually marking him. Two big men, both obviously played Aussie rules, and the ball comes out to Connolly and it's a tough shot to take on. He takes it on, great height in it, but Tommy Walsh has to do better. A little nudge, he catches it in the breadbasket back of the net. Shane Ryan could have even smothered it a bit better. It's a terrible goal to concede. It's not as if he went up and plucked it out of the air.
Yeah, and if you look, Shane Ryan, I think he could have, if you look at it coming in here, first of all, he caught it low down, as Kieran says. That ball should have been gone. It should have been burst out the field. Shane Ryan could have come out a little bit quicker. I thought it was just an easy, soft goal. Look, there's nothing you can do about a freak. It could so easily have been Kerry coming out with a win, just about, and they would have built from there. But I just thought that Kerry set up today for a game that is never going to come now.
All right then, well done to Cork. But who will oppose Cork in this year's Munster final? Well, Tipperary and Limerick were battling for that honour yesterday to make the final. I'm watching the drama unfold there with Breed Stack and Marty Morrissey.
There's Adrian Enright laying it off, needs a little bit more support. Ian Corbett is there. Christy went through, going for the return. Backfires Hugh Burke, waiting for it patiently as Sean McSween. He's made a bit of space for himself, and he hits it superbly.
That's brilliant patient play from Limerick. Saw that against Waterford last week.
Alan Campbell. Mile Rovers just outside Clonmel. Great football territory down in Tipperary. Robbie Kiley laying it off, good ball. There's an opportunity here. Coming across, there's a little flick. Oh, and Quinlivan and O'Sullivan combined to give us one of the features of the first half. That is his first touch, the All-Star from 2016. It's also the first save by Donald O'Sullivan. Hugh Burke, Gordon Brown, to Burke once more. Sean McSweeney, Hugh Burke. Sean McSweeney gone for the return pass. Goes to Tommy Childs instead. Nice little return by Sean McSweeney. Oh, brilliant goal. Fantastic, Limerick. What a movement.
Super. but they needed that. Great ball in through as well by Tommy Childs, and just superly slotted underneath the goalkeeper.
Limerick leading by 4 points. Ball inside. Here's a chance. Oh, fantastic goal. Kelly and Fang. Oh, my word. The Tipperary defence were sleeping in LIT Gaelic grounds. Colonel Kennedy. Kevin Fang. No mark given. Tipperary doing a little bit better. Back again for his Fang. Turns, shoots and scores. This is way better, Tipperary. Colin was shocked to see, giving it over towards Brian Fox. It's Conor Sweeney with a high dropping ball that drops over the crossbar. It's his 6th point of the match and his 2nd from play. Bill Maher. Shot from way out the field on its way, dropping in, dropping off the post. It's a touch and the ball is in the back of the net. The referee has no doubt that the player came rushing in, and the player in question is Liam Casey from Kerr. Where was the big midfielder? That's the question. Ball rebounded, in he comes, back in the net, legitimate to me. Right now, Limerick have the advantage. They have possession. Dara Tracy scored a point at the start of the second half. Flicks one through, there's an opportunity here. It's dropping over the bar. Is that the winning score for Keane Sheehan? Still good work by the fullback, Jimmy Feehan. Michael Quinlivan giving it back to his fullback. And the ball has been blocked, but the referee has blown his whistle for the late challenge of Quinlivan. And the referee, I think, is giving a free to Tipperary. 74 minutes, 30 seconds. 30 seconds to go. This would be some equaliser if Conor Sweeney can put this over the bar. From the sideline. It's floating in. It's curling in. It's off the post! And it's over the bar! Now that is sheer class. Absolutely brilliant, Conor Sweeney. And the sides are level for the 5th time. Is there a winner? In extra time, Brian Fox gets by the first opponent. He's gone all the way. He's going to have a goal. He has a shot and it's over the bar. Brian Fox. Ian Corbett going for the long ball. It's a good ball. And the mark is given. And a great mark by Seamus O'Carroll. And it is a free to the right of the post to level the match for the 8th occasion and force the game surely to penalties. And he has miscued it. And has it gone right and wide? It has. Wow. Huge disappointment for Limerick. There was an opportunity there, but the ball was sent wide. The referee blows the full-time whistle. And Limerick are out of the Munster Championship, and Tipperary just get there by the skin of their teeth. Full-time score at the Gaelic grounds in Limerick. Limerick, 2 goals, 11 points. Tipperary, 1 goal, 15 after extra time. Tipperary are in the Munster football final.
Indeed they are, and it was great for them, Tomás, but you'd have to say it was tough in Limerick.
A very tough day, as it was two equally matched teams. I really enjoyed it. They went at each other. It was totally Limerick in the first half, totally Tip in the second half. Extra time, first half was very cagey, and then it all exploded. It was really exciting. I thought we'd definitely have penalties. We didn't, but I think Limerick will regret it. I think they had so many chances to actually finish that game. I think in the first half, they were absolutely outstanding. They hit 2-3 in a row. They went in at half-time, and they were 2 6-5 points up. They were spraying ball around. They were really... Tipperary, I think, struggled to put a hand on them physically. They had plenty of bodies back, but they weren't putting a hand on it. And here is a brilliant ball across from Tony McCarthy straight into Killian Fahey, split the whole defence apart. And at half-time, I was thinking, not a hope to Clare will get back into it. They rattled off 1-6 straight after the half-time. But Limerick will look back with regret. I mean, despite Tipperary coming back, despite everything that Tipperary did, Limerick had the opportunities. You had Sean McSweeney missing it. You had Donal O'Sullivan, who had put balls over before he missed one. I think Limerick people will be aggrieved. And the next play where we see Hugh Burke running through, and there's no doubt here that there was a penalty. It was at a key moment in the game. Here we have Hugh Burke coming through, and he was pulled back. There's no doubt about it. It was a penalty. It was a stonewall penalty. He still had a good chance. Had the ball gone in, there would have been no issue. And I think it came down to the final of extra time where they came forward. Ian Corbett put a long ball in, and it was Seamus O'Carroll who had come on. And it was a brilliant... I thought, oh, no, what a way for Tipperary to actually lose the game by getting a mark. And he caught it. He possibly could have, should have played on and took it on the swing, but you'd feel for him here, but definitely was a point they should have taken. You know, I think Limerick will definitely... They've had a great season. Their work is done brilliantly. The coaching is excellent. Their application is brilliant. They've had a great season. They've won the McGrath Cup, but they'll be disappointed. What a chance to go into a Munster final. They weren't to know it, that Cork were there, but Tipperary will fancy their chances against Cork.
They don't have a fear of them. Let's look at Tipperary now, because you've pointed out where it went wrong for Limerick, but Tip did well to come back.
Tip did well. I mean, I thought at the start of the second half that they were in trouble. I couldn't see them getting back into it. Bit by bit, they clawed, they fought. Their big players played well, no more than this man. Conor Sweeney was outstanding. 54 metres, they straight over, room to spare. It was the one that actually brought them into extra time. But here we had Bill Kiley, who kicked a great score, and that was to level it up. But here, I think Limerick again will be disappointed, where their pressure in the first half was so brilliant. Brian Fox, who made such a huge difference when he came on at half-time for Tipperary, turned things for Tipperary. He was actually surprised he had so much time in the ball here.
It's plenty of Limerick.
It was a brilliant score. He was looking to pass. He wandered all the way up, and it was so unlike Limerick. As you'll see it here, it's great. He's looking up, he's wanting to pass it. There wasn't a hand put on him, but he still had to kick it, and it was under pressure. It was towards the end of the game, and I think Tipperary just about deserved it in the end, but Limerick will rue the chances that they had. Tipperary look forward to the Munster final now, a different Munster final, but knockout it is, and they'll give themselves every chance to it.
Yeah, as you say, they've no fear going up against Cork. Well, coming up after the break, we football highlights from the three other provinces with the hurling qualifiers and Camogie. We'll see you shortly.
The stands may be silent, but we know you're standing tall behind us. SuperValue, support where you're from.
After a disappointing Six Nations climax, is it time for Ireland to bounce back? The Autumn Nations Cup, part of the Guinness series, starts here. First up, old rivals Wales at the Aviva before Andy Farrell's men take on England and Georgia. With 4 weekends of action-packed rugby to look forward to, can Ireland finish the year on a high? Ireland versus Wales, Friday at 6 p.m. on RTE2 and RTE Player.
Millions of people trust Head & Shoulders. It deeply cleans and helps fight dandruff, oil, itch and dryness. Clinically proven, up to 100% flake-free and a 100% clear mind. Proudly the world's number one shampoo.
New natural soups from Knorr. Made with sustainably grown vegetables. New Knorr Natural Soups. Try them out today.
Every one of us is still at risk from COVID-19. But every time we do the right thing, we're protecting ourselves and the people around us. So remember, we all need to take a step back. Let's make an extra effort to keep cleaning those hands and wear a face covering when you're shopping or on public transport. If you sneeze or cough, cover it or have a tissue handy. And download the COVID Tracker app to help reduce the spread of the virus. Because COVID-19 is still a problem, and we're all the answer.
Every day, a new race begins. Taking care of my kids and being an athlete. I need daily support, energy levels, mental performance, and immune system. That's why I choose Pharmaton multivitamins with their unique ginseng formula. Pharmaton, to help you stay unstoppable.
True comfort food.
What is that? For me, it's food you can enjoy that bit more because you know you can trust it. Mm. Take pork and bacon with the Board Beer quality mark. It's reassuring to know that there's always someone out there inspecting how your pork and bacon is produced and checking where it comes from. So you can tuck into a tasty rasher sambo or a carbonara or some nice roast pork.
Not hungry, huh?
Always choose pork and bacon with the Board Beer quality mark.
Mmm, legend.
So many ways to enjoy Brennan's family, man. So what will it be today? Ah, cheese toasty. Good choice. Brennan's. Today's bread today.
Time is a gift. When it's gone, it's gone. So don't live your life on hold. It's time to own it. It'sforwomen.ie offer great value car insurance for those on the go. It's always at hand. It's always online. You can get the cover you need day or night, and the rest of the time is your own. On the web, on demand, on the go. It'sforwomen.ie. Online car insurance for those on the go.
No matter what you use to fight a cold, you could add Vicks Vapor Rub to help relieve your blocked nose, sore throat, congestion and cough due to cold. To help you sleep like a baby, Vicks Vapor Rub.
From the award-winning Vortex condensing oil boiler to the highly efficient Arona heat pump, Grant has been providing innovative home heating technology for over 40 years.
At least we know the boiler's reliable.
Think heating, think Grant. Visit grant.eu.
They travel from all four corners. A journey of thousands who become one.
You're welcome back. Well, now we're going to head to Connacht, where Galway, of course, went straight into the final after getting a walkover from Sligo. But the other semi-final, we're told, would be no walkover, as Mayo took on Roscommon. Let's see how it turned out as we join Desi Dolan and Darren Maloney.
So Mayo with the wind in the first half. 5 years since they've been in the Connacht final. Paddy Durkin attacking. And Paddy Durkin still going. This is brilliant from Paddy Durkin. Roscommon just let him go and go and go. He didn't need a second invitation. Puts the ball over the bar. Mayo lead 2-1. There was a massive tussle between Brian Stack and Aidan O'Shea. Doney trying to weave his way through, and no better man to do that. Here's Connor Cox. Forced backwards. Connor Daly is the fullback, but he's playing further out the field. Tygo Rourke. And now it is Brian Stack. Leaves his man-marking of Aidan O'Shea. And now Tygo Rourke has got through. O'Rourke on his left boot, tricky enough angle, slots the ball over. That's good from Roscommon. 1991 was the last time that Roscommon managed back-to-back championship wins over Mayo. Long time ago. Here's Lee Keegan. And that's Dermot O'Connor outside of the right boot. Players love those when they go over. And that one has sailed between the posts.
And he has this in a lock. That's a brilliant score. Outside of the boot, from distance, using the breeze to get it over the bar, but a brilliant score by Dermot O'Connor.
Mayo have had four different scorers. Roscommon only 1 point from play so far. Their last score was in the ninth minute. Aidan O'Shea getting space again. Turns back onto the left. Matty Ruan outside the Roscommon 45-metre line. Roscommon have defenders back in position. Dermot O'Connor in a great position. They let him go. O'Connor, goal! Mayo make their move at the Hyde.
Great play by Owen McLaughlin. Found Dermot O'Connor on the wing. Brought it in, and what a neat finish by Dermot O'Connor. Stroked it low and hard to the bottom of the net, and Colm Lavin could do nothing about that.
Niall Daly. Enda Smith. been marked now by Stephen Cohen. And Downey just... O'Shane Mullen out of the way. And Downey tight on the end line. It's too tight to have a shot. He's in a better angle now. And that is gorgeous from Downey Smith. Now, if they can move it quickly, O'Shane Mullen's out of position. Here is Ronan Daly for Roscommon. Aidan O'Shea ended up on the floor in the centre of the field. He's back on his feet now. Connor Cox slipping. Ran away from Enda Smith. Ball turned over. Mayo in the first half scored 4 points from turnovers, and they've turned Roscommon over here. Furthest forward is Killian O'Connor. Here's Kevin McLaughlin. Early stages of the second half. Roscommon, the team who need to start big, but here come Mayo. Loftus just lets it go. That's Chris Barrett. He should be fullback. Kevin McLaughlin. And now Killian O'Connor. And O'Connor has tapped that over. Here's Chris Barrett. Can Roscommon turn him over? Yes, they can. He was isolated. There were three Roscommon men near him. Downey Smith. Smith couldn't get the shot away. Can he get somebody in a better position? Cottle Compton. Mayo. Tackling hard, putting pressure on the ball all the time. That is Niall Daly. It all needs to go over for Roscommon at this stage, and that's a beauty from Niall Daly. They put on a real spurt. That's 4 points without reply for Roscommon. Kevin McLaughlin. McLaughlin still. Now, Paddy Durkin. Open road in front of him. Daly comes across Niall to try and challenge him. Durkin still going. Enda Smith there, Durkin through. Remember his point in the first half. That one is just as good, if not even better, and it's come at a huge time, just when they needed it, just as the tide started to turn against them.
Inspirational score by Paddy Durkin. Roscommon doing particularly well, 4 points on the trot, and Paddy Durkin makes a lung-busting run.
Mayo's championship campaign looks set to continue. Referee could have played advantage there, didn't need to, as Mayo just dictate things. Connacht final next weekend. It appears they're going to be in action 5 weekends in a row, and another point has been added, extending their lead, and it's Conor Loftus. James Horan giving, well, as many subs as he's allowed, a run to get them involved. Here's Sean Maluli. Most common player ended up down on the ground, Kieran Lennon. That one has gone over. It's a nice score from Dermot Murta. It's constant work rate from these Mayo guys, 1 to 26, all over the field when they get in, particularly the forwards. They have just been full of running. They've had a busy schedule over the last number of weeks, but there is the full-time whistle, and Mayo leave Hyde Park by sealing a place in this year's Connacht final against Galway. They have beaten Roscommon by 116 to 13 points at Hyde Park.
You know, we missed a couple of scores, our conversion rate as well. We had a lot of chances, and you know, we'd have been disappointed that we didn't probably convert a few more. You know, it wasn't over windy. There was a nice breeze there, but we have to learn from that. And this is a young panel though, and they definitely have massive ability.
We got a few early scores, and our movement was good. It looked like our energy was good, and we got into a lead, and we kept that lead for the game. So I thought we controlled the game. Possession-wise, our return from shots wouldn't have been where it needs to be. So that's something for us to look at. But look at overall, I thought our attitude and our approach to the game was very strong.
Yeah, James Horan, I think, has every reason to be pleased, Kieran. But yeah. Roscommon were disappointing, were they?
They were, Des. They never got to the pitch. But you got to credit Mayo. You know, Mayo essentially are in transition. You know, when you look at the experience that James Horan's left out, he's blooded new players. We're in championship mode here, and they really performed. They always control the game. They play. They're one team that plays with a high press, and they're willing to play very high up the pitch. They actually play the way Kerry should play, if I'm being honest. But they squeeze teams and they force Roscommon to go long on the kickouts. I thought it was a really solid performance. Killian O'Connor back to his best up front. Paddy Durkin, they got the key matchups right. Chris Barrett in the back of the edge of the square, he gave them a bit of security back there. A real solid performance, never in doubt. Really poor from Roscommon. Never really got going. They had very few options in their forward line. They never penetrated the Mayo defence. Mayo comfortable defensively all day. But a lot of positives from Mayo's perspective. Blooding new players, going through transition very, very quickly, and they'd be quietly happy tonight.
Yeah, you were impressed with their work rate, Tomás.
Yeah, I think the work rate, just how direct they are. I love the way Mayo are very, very direct. But it was their work rate that impressed me. I mean, all over the pitch, I think they had... Roscommon had forced and unforced errors. I mean, Lavin got caught here. He was swallowed up by Ryan O'Donoghue and Aidan O'Shea, and it ended up in a McLaughlin to win a free-in. I think also some of the poor balls in Mayo were constantly out in front. They were constantly winning the 50-50 battles. I think basically, if you put it into a nutshell, Des, Mayo were better on the ball than Roscommon were when they were on the ball, and they were better without the ball than Roscommon were. They worked harder and they were a lot more direct. And I think that was the bottom line. Conor Cox hesitates here. This was a typical. You had Oisín Mullen, Chris Barrett, Paddy Durkin, Loftus hits Enda Smith an awful rap, and then straight. Look, it's direct. Whatever way they go, they'll try to just bring it as quick as they can up the pitch. I'd have no doubt that James Horan has a lot to do still. There was times in that match where they won't be happy with their finishing, but overall, I think he has a lot of positives to have. Yeah. And I do think he was very disappointing. The one thing from all these clips is the lack of intensity, whatever about the forwards, whatever about the finishing, but the lack of getting a hand on a man coming out of defence here, the lack of pressure on them. You turn that over and you see what Mayo were doing to Roscommon. And it was unlike Roscommon, because you see Roscommon for the last 2 years, I think knockout championship, Roscommon would be disgusted that they didn't actually just show up here today.
Well, the goal, you mentioned that they missed quite a few chances, they did, but you were both hugely impressed with the goal, Kane.
Yeah, well, it was a great finish, Des, but it also finished the game, essentially. You know, Roscommon were fighting a battle after that. Like, Roscommon have been very solid all year in terms of their setup. Roscommon went long in the kick-out today. They reckon they had the physicality in that sector, but Mayo won their fair share, even though Roscommon did dominate it at times, where they didn't get any return off it. But the one aspect for me today from Mayo, and you could see it, was they weren't going to get sucked in. When Roscommon dropped men back, they always had guys out around that mid-sector that were ready to drop back into the space and track the runners. They didn't get sucked forward like they did against Tyrone. You know, Chris Barrett was back there, Lee Keegan. And then when this ball comes wide, they obviously go down the central channel, but when it comes wide, they're left in a typical 3-on-2 situation. You have Matthew Ruan, Owen McLaughlin and Dermot O'Connor, and they come hard at the Roscommon defence and they get sucked in, and Dermot O'Connor is allowed glide in on this side. And it's a really, really good finish to come in on a tight angle from there. He's only one spot to go, is that far corner, and I think that made it about 1-6 to 2 points, Des, and that essentially was game over. But like Roscommon, they've been solid all year, Des, and you know they're 3-4 years down their journey, and there was a lot more expected of them today. They just didn't never performed in my opinion.
Mayo seem to have this ability to raise it. You know, you think they're actually down, they
Mayo
come
are
up
in good space.
They're in very good space. Yeah,
it's a good weekend all round for Mayo. I saw a Mayo jersey outside the White House on the news there earlier. Anyway, well done to them. We had two quarterfinals in Ulster this weekend as well, so let's see how they unfolded now. Beginning with yesterday's clash of Cavan and Antrim. Des Curran reports.
Having put their league relegation quickly behind them with a sensational win against Monaghan last weekend, Cavan were strongly fancied to see off Antrim and advance to Ulster's Final Four. And they were in front inside the opening minute through Oisín Pearson after Jason McLaughlin's effort had fallen short. Oisín Kiernan added to that before Antrim settled to their task, opening their account with an excellent outside of the right boot efforts from Dermot McAleese. Paddy Cunningham then landed a free, before 2009 All-Star nominee Michael McCann took matters into his own hands. A storming run down the right-hand side ended with a left-footed effort eased over, and Antrim with the lead for the first time. Paddy Cunningham's return to the inter-county scene after 6 years away was one of the feel-good stories of late. His trusty left boot seemed to devastating effect here, and Lenny Harbinson's men led by two. With Antrim sitting deep and Garrod McKiernan bottled up, Cavan needed others to produce. Kieran Brady would fire over his second point of the half, but a black card in stoppage time for Killian Brady brought an end to a wasteful and uncomfortable first half for the home team. After Killian Clark had registered the first point on the resumption, Cavan needed their match winner of last week, Raymond Gallaghan, to spring to the rescue after a great Antrim move ended with Patrick Gallagher almost finishing what he started. And that chance spurned looked a costly one when Cavan would go on to land the next 3 points to make it 5 unanswered either side of the break. Oisin Kiernan with his second of the day to make it 9 points to 6. Oran Eastwood and Tomás McCann were sprung from the bench in an effort to get the scoreboard ticking over again for Antrim. And while the latter landed a free to stem the flow, straight from the kick-out, Garrod McKiernan finally found some space to operate in and took impressive advantage of it. A big final quarter would see Cavan home, 1 point playing with 13 with 2 players sin bins. Conor Murray looked like setting up a grandstand finish when this point reduced the deficit to 2. But Cavan would kick the final 2 scores through Thomas Edward Donoghue and McKiernan as they emerged 13 points to 9 victors. None of the drama of a week ago, but in knockout football, a win is a win. As debut inter-county management campaigns go, Ryan McMenamin could hardly have asked for a more challenging one. And today, against a man he worked under in Tyrone's famous 03 All-Ireland winning year, he sent his Fermanagh side out with eyes in a provincial semi-final. And a great start, Darragh McGurn on his championship debut with a superb opening score. With both sides happy to sit in, space and scores were at a premium in the early stages. Desi O'Hare levelled with a free before Kieran Corrigan found a gap and exploited it impressively. Against packed defences, accuracy was needed. Paul Devlin with a terrific pick out here, but O'Hare ended with a white flag rather than a green one. With the Burren man catching the eye at one end, his opposite number was doing likewise at the other. Tomás Corrigan followed up on scores from a mark and a free with his superb effort from play. He would end the half with 4 of Fermanagh's 6. But a strong end to the half from down would see them into the dressing rooms, a point to the good as they reeled off the final 3 scores through Jerome Johnston, Caelan Mooney and Barry O'Hagan. And after that one off his left, O'Hagan then opened the second half scoring with a beauty off his right. And for the first time in the game, a 2-point lead. 2 Corrigan frees tied it up, but then the game's big moment. Caelan Mooney's influence on this down team, one that can't be underestimated. He showed a clean pair of heels to the Fermanagh defence before finding Daniel McGuinness. O'Hare found the net, taking his tally to 1-4. With Mooney's pace, one way to nullify a tight defence, long-range accuracy another. And in Barry O'Hagan, down had that man, his third of the day as good as the 2 that preceded it. Fermanagh pushed to narrow the gap, but gaps appeared at the other end. Substitute Corey Quinn added his name to the scorers to power down into a commanding 6-point lead. Fermanagh lost Owen Donnelly to a black card and Down hammered home their superiority with points from Jerome and a brace from Ryan Johnston. And while the home side gave the scoreboard a slightly healthier look with late points from Paul McCusker and Danny Taig, Down would run out comfortable winners, 115 to 11 points, to book a semi-final date with...
Yeah, comfortable enough. So Down and Cavan in the semi-finals was probably what was expected all along, but the others gave them a fight.
They did, yeah. Both probably Fermanagh and Antrim played similar. Fermanagh reverted to tight days and dropped 14 men behind the ball, left Corrigan up front, but Down's pace came through in the end. It's very hard for teams to maintain that for 70 minutes. They eventually get broken down if they don't have the firepower up front. I suppose the only positive from a Cavan perspective is they won the game. It was their 4th game in 4 weeks. It was a flat performance. They kicked a lot of wides, dropped a lot short. Antrim very good in the first half. Michael McCann was excellent. Paddy Cunningham was good up front. But they brought on Tomás McCann in the second half. He got injured straight away. They had no firepower. Cavan were able to pull away with Oisin Kiernan and Garrod McKiernan with points in the end in the last quarter. But a poor Cavan performance. They face their 5th game in a row next week. You know, Down, you've got to think, are a little bit fresher. I think Down could come through on that one, but it would be an interesting semi-final.
All right then, well, after the break, we're going to turn our attention to Leinster and a new era for Dublin football as Desi Farrell and co begin their quest to create even more history.
FAI Chief Executive John Delaney.
A portrait of one of Irish sport's most controversial figures.
The only public figure that I compare him to is Donald Trump.
If you look at so many public statements the FAI released over the years, John's name is like front and centre in so many of them.
He had come in, decided not to answer questions, and really had handed it over to them.
I've read my statement already.
In other words, dropped them right in it.
The John Delaney Story, Monday at 9:35 on RTE One and RTE Player.
With heavy snowfall across the country, visibility is poor, so Santa's going to have to keep his eyes peeled tonight.
Santa won't miss us now.
But what about everyone else?
The lights, let's go! Bring the torches!
Guys, we're up!
Guys, I don't want to hide anymore.
With Virgin Mobile, there's nothing hidden. We'll let you upgrade whenever you want. Never lock your phone to our network, and we'll make it clear when your phone is paid off. Virgin Mobile, nothing hidden.
Energy beats everything. Lucozade Energy.
Yes. It's incredible, absolutely unforgettable. People say it's only chemical, but it can't be. It's incredible what you're doing to me. If I say it all, every word and every syllable, you will see. It's incredible what you're doing to me.
For a magical Christmas with Argos, you're good to go.
At Liberty Insurance, we wondered...
Car insurance, what's important for you?
I always go third party. Kind of boring, but you've got backup, you've got cover.
Windscreen cover is very important as well.
Breakdown assistance would be most important for us.
Inside cars are a mystery, Jimmy.
Well, I can't even fix the tyre.
Liberty Insurance puts you in the driving seat. Only pay for what you need at libertyinsurance.ie.
It's good to have that choice that we can pick and choose what we do want.
Take control with Liberty Insurance.
Woo-hoo! Ready for the real
world. How you feeling? How you feeling? I think I'm gonna make the earth shake. Break it down, break it down. What's the word? I'm not even running fast for the fans, cause I'm always switching on them. Fix shit when I'm drifting on them. I don't wanna lose, I don't wanna go, so I do nothing to keep me in the box. The accolades don't add to the zero. We go where the ego goes. We know we don't see a lot of homegrown folks with a stone cold flow. How you feeling? How you feeling? I think I'm gonna make the earth shake.
Potato. 73 calories per bottle, same refreshing taste. New Rock Shore Light.
The stands may be silent, but we know you're standing tall behind us. Super Value, support where you're from.
You're welcome back. Our hurling and camogie still to come, but it's Leinster football now because Laois took on Longford today for a place in the provincial semi-finals. It was quite a game. And watching this one was Liam Ahern.
Ball won there by Kevin Diffley. The Longford midfielder plays this one forward. Gets the return hand pass again and again. Longford comes sweeping down the centre of the park. Gets the pass away now towards Desi Reynolds. Reynolds going forward. He's lost it. He's won it back. Reynolds! Oh, what a goal! Super goal for Desi Reynolds and for Longford. ran at the heart of the Laois defence, low underneath the body of Niall Corbett, into the back of the net. First goal of the game goes the way of the home side. Laois take the kick out down this near side. Robert Piggott brings this one forward. Long ball sent inside. Peeling away, winning possession of it. Hand pass off, finds Paul Kingston. Kingston going through. Oh, what a goal. What a finish. Right down the heart of the Longford defence went Laois. And the pass was laid off to Paul Kingston. And the finish was absolutely superb. Lacey back across towards Kingston. The goal scorer, 45 out. Confidence behind him. That is going to be a monster of a score. The umpires look at each other. And that is a super score from Paul Kingston. Picked up by Donal McKelligott. Wing back and cap. 1 point to him. Now Barry O'Farrell back across again. Here's an opportunity for a second point for the captain. It is Donal McKelligott from wing back with his second point of the afternoon for Longford. And Laois in there just still haven't managed to win it, but Connerton does well to win it back. It's the hand pass away, peeling away here, chance of a goal, opportunity, brilliant save by the goalkeeper. It was Donal McKelligott. Well, you felt if that could have been a forward that was there, it could have been a different result. Back towards Desi Reynolds, the goal scorer in the first half, pops this ball forward, well gathered there. Now back again towards Milla. Hand pass again, now finds Reynolds. Reynolds is through here, one goal to his name. Brilliant save again by the goalkeeper. The rebound is in and over the crossbar. Desi Reynolds was through, one-on-one with keeper Niall Corbett, who made a tremendous save yet again. Now one again by Desi Reynolds. One goal to his name, could have had a second. Runs at the heart of the Laois defence again. Plenty of pace as Reynolds, that is a super score for him. The loser, of course, this afternoon. There are no second chances. That's the goalkeeper, Niall Corbett, on the attacking 45-yard line as he delivers that ball into Mullally, who does well, shows the experience, wins the mark, and is awarded the attacking mark. And this now an opportunity for Mullally to cut the gap. First action for him. And well, that's a delightful point for Ross Mullally, and that's exactly what he can do. So at 16 and a half minutes, the restart has started and the kick out has been intercepted and won by Paul Kingston. Lays this one back as far as Gary Walsh. Walsh kicks that one in. There's the levelling score. Evan O'Carroll's hand pass further inside. Here's an opportunity now. Back across towards Mark Timmins. Timmins lays this one. Shot comes in. It's hit the crossbar and come back out. And the effort was from Michael Keogh, which hit the crossbar. The rebound is first to react with a Laois. Into the hands there now of Sean O'Flynn. O'Flynn kicks that one in, and O'Flynn puts it over the crossbar this time. It's a two-point lead. There is the final whistle. Laois have done enough. Laois do advance to the Leinster Senior Football Championship semi-final. It's finished. Longford 114, Laois 116.
I think the big passage of play was when Laois hit us for 7 points on the trot. We had six wides in a row, so that's, you know, in the end, that's what has cost us. We weren't fit to keep that scoreboard taken over, and unfortunately, you know, we have suffered because of that.
Great to get to win. Delighted with it. You know, it's obviously a big game for us. You know, we're not consistent enough to be looking past anybody, so certainly Longford were all we were thinking about, and you know, we didn't play particularly well, but you know, again, it's probably a recurring theme with us, just delighted to get over the line and keep grinding out.
Well, that's what they've done. They've ground out a couple of games recently. Tough look on Longford too. They had their chances, Tomás.
They did. They had a great start. They rattled off a good few scores. Nimna, Connerton and Gallagher. Darren Gallagher was excellent again from the route around the middle of the field, and they were going very well. And Laois, even though they were poor against Fermanagh a few weeks ago, I thought they were that little bit better. I thought they showed great character in the second half. Desi Reynolds got a great goal in the first half. I thought it was a very enjoyable game, Des. One of the more enjoyable games of the weekend. There was a lot more direct running. But I think the winning of it was Paul Kingston kept him in touch in that first half with a goal. But I think in the second half, those 7 points they rattled off, but it came from the work rate all around the pitch from Laois. They actually got stuck in. Niall Corbett had a couple of brilliant saves, and in the end they pulled away. But I think Laois actually showed great character. The problem for them now is that they face Dublin next weekend, which is end of the road for them. But
that's character building as well, I suppose.
I don't know what type of a character it's going to build, but it'll build something. But it was a good... I think Mike was saying that they didn't play particularly well. Longford will be missed an awful lot of chances, created an awful lot of chances, and it is tough then when you have to turn around and face...
Well, as Mike says, they can only do what's in front of them.
Exactly.
And they're winning, and they're doing their best. Well done, Laois. Elsewhere in Leinster, of course, Dublin began their quest for another All-Ireland title when they took on Westmeath last night. Here's Hugh Cahill.
Dublin happy to just pass it around, and Westmeath, as you can see, super defensive format. And how long will they be able to keep Dublin at bay? So far, it's worked a treat inside the opening couple of minutes. And for Fenton, sideline ball, looking for a run. A pass just about getting past the first defender. First scoring chance, swing of the boot. Beautiful score. One pass from the finds the man, and the swing and the score from Dean Rock. Cooper underneath this one, again under a bit of pressure. Dublin managed to win it though. Fenton gets it back, bit of room for the shot, and Brian Fenton looks like it's going left off the post. And a chance back for Dublin. Kieran Kilkenny, little dummy from him, brings it onto his right boot. Can he get the angle round? That's a superb score from Kieran Kilkenny off the post. A little bit fortunate. That was the dummy. Beautifully done. So Jason Daly to try and pick out a Westmeath teammate. But again, it's broken for Dublin. Seem to have all the right players in the right position and read the goal kick as play continues. Hand pass from Bugler. Ball inside. Bugler gets it back. Left footed strike. As clean as you like from Sean Bugler. Three scores in the space of 90 seconds, and Dublin starting to open up. Ball inside. Taken by Lachlan. Lachlan, first real touch for him. Left footed strike as he got it on target. That is a wonderful score from Luke Lachlan. The deficit down to just 2 points. Dublin leading by 4 points to two. Scully. Picked off the ground. Nice little hand pass to James McCarthy. In it goes. Awkward enough one for Paddy Small, but he took it on a slide and then might have space for the shot. Can he bring it around enough off the post and over? He did bring it around enough. Had to whip the inside of the foot to get enough curl on that one. Strength as well to get back on his feet. Two Westmeath defenders in front of him. Beautiful. Off the post and over it goes. Well, plenty for your thoughts, Jack Cooney. Cooper. Westmeath getting numbers back. Johnny Cooper takes the return pass. Bit of space opening up. Can he get the shot on target from there? Beautiful score by Johnny Cooper. Doesn't score a huge amount, but I tell you, that was a great strike at full tilt as well. And Dublin hit 10 points on the board. Wall of blue jerseys finding it all too easy to keep Westmeath at bay. Canutes inside, ball it goes. Now here's Ray Kinnellan. Finish the first half with a point if they can manage it. It's a tight angle though, and that's a really good effort, Ray Kinnellan, for Westmeath. What a point that was by the big man. Oh, lovely hand to get to that ball. Was it broken kindly for Heslin? It has done. Good strength by Heslin, trying to create space for the shot. Range and the angle. That is a brilliant score by Heslin. Superb. That's why he has been such a key player for Westmeath over the years. Ray Kinnellan. It's warm with jerseys around him though. Kinnellan decides to give the pass away. Martin, here he goes. This will be a lovely score if they can finish from here. Little dummy first of all by O'Toole. Then back to Martin. Martin to finish. Really good strike and a really good score from Westmeath. Much better. Looks at the pass inside. Too easy to read. Interception and a chance for Dublin to launch attack. Fenton. Playing with his head up, looking for the pass inside. That's a really good ball. If it works out, it has worked out brilliantly. Chance here for Kilkenny. And over it goes. Thought for a second he might strike for goal, but a beautiful pass from Fenton. Kilkenny didn't have to break stride, and that was the finish. Going to have to make something happen here. Opting to just hold on to the ball. Here's Johnny Cooper. Gives it back to Conor O'Callaghan. And O'Callaghan to McCarthy. Kilkenny from long distance. Kilkenny fancies the shot. That's a beautiful score from Kieran Kilkenny. Super strike by Dusaye. launching himself forward. Can he get any room for the shot? He did have a bit of time there, but just didn't fancy it for whatever reason. Westmead still in possession, though. Here's Duncan. And it goes to Kennellan. Kennellan trying to make space for himself. A long way out, though. Lovely strike with the left boot. And that's another gorgeous point by the Westmead midfielder. I tell you, he hasn't got a huge amount, but the scores that he has got have been absolutely brilliant. Westmead in possession with Ronan Wallace. There's the full-time whistle. So it's a comfortable Leinster football quarter-final victory for Dublin, who march on against Westmead. They are out of the Championship Four this year. It's been a very brief spell for them. For Desi Farrell and for this Dublin side, they have bigger fish to fry, and they march on to the semi-finals of the Leinster Football Championship. Easy enough in the end for the Dubs and defending All-Ireland champions. They've beaten Westmead here at Amore Park in Port Laois, County Laois, by 22 points to 11.
Yeah, Kieran, it was a comprehensive enough win for Dublin. The work what stood out for me, many of us wondered, will they be able to maintain that?
Yeah, I suppose that's one of the big things you look out for, Des, you know, on the back of, I suppose, Desi Farrell coming in, new management, new setup. You're just wondering, is that same level of hunger and desire and that intensity to win, I suppose, six in a row still there? And it was quite obvious last night it was. The work rate right from the start was that, particularly in the forward unit, was top class, I have to say.
You won your All-Irelands and you had your questions about hunger and appetite. It's keeping it going here, and you've highlighted, Kieran, where we see them as a group working.
Yeah, well, Tomás won the All-Irelands test, unfortunately, not me. The thing about it this here, Des, is Kieran Kilkenny, and you look at the position of Conor Callan and Kieran Kilkenny, and you look where Johnny Cooper is. Johnny Cooper is out of position. Kieran Kilkenny has just pressed the kick out. They had seven pressing four. They've put the pressure on. They've slowed Westmead down on the kick out. They've dropped back in now, this mid-sector, where they're going to press. Westmead come across. Lucky to get away with it, but when the ball goes in, look, Conor Callan is, you know, in the left half-back position, and who's after drifting all the way back after first pressing the kick out is Kilkenny, who was phenomenal last night with 5 points, and they regroup. And I think, Des, it's that ability to, play, I suppose. It's not the process, it's the system, that the work rate of the forwards, they all cover each other. They get back around the field. They know when they're out of position. They know the structure they have to keep. And here's another example of it. This is a score, and it's a brilliant ball from Fenton. He picks out Kilkenny going through Ray Kennellan. Kilkenny, you know, gets a strong hand in here, gets it, and over the bar. But from the next kick out, Kilkenny stays in, Des. Conor Callan is drifting out. Kennellan is heaving. Look, he's down. He's after chasing Kilkenny in the last play. O'Callaghan knows the time to get out, to get into that. He's now in the half-forward line. Dublin get back. They get their press on, the work rate, which I thought was phenomenal all night. They pressurise Westmead. O'Callaghan's back. Look at Dean Rock then comes into the picture. He's tracking his marker, but he's getting back there. O'Callaghan is still back. And who are the two guys that come up and force that pressure on Westmead and force him into a mistake? Rock and O'Callaghan. So they had this ability to cover for each other, and I think that's what caused Westmead difficulty. They pulled Westmead all over the place last night, Des, in terms of their forward movement. And it's very difficult for Westmead because they're just not at the same level of Dublin, and people are saying, oh, well, they should be pressing the kick out, they should be going defensive, they should be flooding midfield. They just don't have that level of ability, and it's very difficult for Jack Cooney it was damage limitation last night. The game was over early doors. But from a Dublin perspective, in terms of their intent, in terms of their work rate and intensity, that was the biggest positive for Desi Farrell.
You mentioned pressing the kickouts. You took an interest in the Westmead kickouts last night, Tomás.
It's hard to get analysis from the performance last night. I think we've touched on it there, that Westmead weren't at the level that Dublin were. But it's just interesting the way Dublin just absolutely dismantled their kickout. You say how strong Cluxton is, and the way they always guarantee possession from that. But if you are going to have a sniff of a chance against Dublin, you're going to have to ensure, I think, no... wonder that Dublin actually pushed up. Westmead failed to put pressure on them. They failed to get bodies back. I think there's a big difference in having bodies back there's an actually engaging. If you have bodies back, like the numbers Westmead, then you have to be making contact. You have to be tight off the ball. You have to be making pressure. But what I was disappointed with Westmead is here we have Cooper for... they've always somebody drifting back. Cooper straight away, when the ball is gone, is going straight back into his position. But Westmead, whatever ball they win, if Dublin are pressed forward, they're going to have to be direct. Here, Jamie Gnu turns back and goes backwards, right? Now, Westmead, when Dublin come against better teams, here you have John Heslin catches it, straight away, turns and bang, direct, okay? And you'll see all the space that is inside in the Dublin defence, okay? And here we have, and it was actually Ronan O'Toole who took an absolute brilliant shot, okay? You're not gonna, it's nothing really about Dublin-Westmead. My point is, Dublin are very aggressive on the press. But if you're good enough on your own kickouts, I thought Westmead weren't good enough on their short kickouts, I thought they weren't good enough on their long kickouts, but I think, I know, I'm just being honest, but
they're just not at the same.
They're not at the same level,
they're
but
same
I
level.
Think what Kieran's piece showed that what Kerry don't have is Dublin's greatest strength amongst their talented players is the balance. When to have enough players up, they always have enough players back, they can rotate back forward. It's what Kerry, you said that Mayo had a better kind of a serving of it than Kerry do, and that's where Kerry, I'm afraid, lacked hugely today.
Forgive me, I thought we finished talking about Kerry in part one of the programme
so
today.
I
take
he was
your
back
point.
Smiling.
All right, find out who would be joining Dublin and Laois in the Leinster semi-finals. We can find out now. The two other quarter-finals saw Offaly meet Kildare and first Wicklow versus Meath.
Meath travelled to Aucrim for their first championship outing of the season to face Wicklow, who already had a win over Wexford under their belts. Although they finished bottom of Division 1, Meath saw out the league with some decent performances and quickly showed what they are capable of. With just 10 minutes played, they'd scored 1-2, Jordan Morris capitalising on a Mark Jackson error. On the 22nd minute, Wicklow opened their account through captain Dean Healy, but it was to be their only point of the half from play, goalkeeper Jackson scoring the other two from frees. As the game progressed, Meath's dominance grew and they looked every inch a top-tier side. On the half-hour mark, Thomas O'Reilly linked up well with Matthew Costello. He blasted the ball to the roof of the net for their second goal of the game, extending Meath's lead to 8 points. Moments later, Meath went on the attack once more with Brian Menton finding space after a 1-2 with Shane McEntee. The midfielder adding a third goal for the visitors, and at the break it was Meath 3-6, Wicklow 3 points. Wicklow kicked two early points in the second half, a free from Shawnee Furlong and this from play from Owen Darcy. But their efforts were futile. There was no stopping Meath, especially in front of goals. Jackson failed to deal with the dropping ball and Joey Wallace pounced, palming to the net 4-11 to 5 points with 13 minutes to play. By this stage, the floodgates were well and truly open. Cathal Hickey started and finished an impressive team move, calmly slotting the ball home for Meath's fifth goal of the afternoon. And they weren't done yet. Two Jordan Morris penalties hit Wicklow for 6 and 7 on what will be a day to forget for Davy Burke's Wicklow. But one to remember for Morris, who finished with 3 goals and 4 points on his championship debut. So Andy McEntee's men march on to the Leinster semi-final on a full-time score of Wicklow 7 points, Meath 7-14. Kildare went into this Leinster quarter-final clash against Offaly at MW Harrow Moor Park, having won 11 successive meetings between the sides in all competitions, Offaly's last victory stretching back to 2006. The opening exchanges were keenly contested. Dara Kerwin showed good strength and composure, kicking the first score of the game inside the first minute. John Mahan's side equalised before points from and Paddy Brophy edged Kildare ahead by 2. With 20 minutes played, just a point separated the sides. A crossfield pass from Anton Sullivan into the path of Keane Farrell created a goal chance, forcing a save from Mark Donlan. Offaly scrambled and John Mahan's side had to be content with a point from the boot of Farrell, but the sides were level 6 points apiece. It was tit for tat for the remainder of the half. Dara Kerwin on his championship debut, twisting and turning before sending over a point. And at the interval, Kildare led 10 points to 9. After the break, Kildare sent over 5 points from Kerwin, Brophy, Masterson, Highland and this from Ben McCormack to put some distance between the sides. 15 points to 11 with 52 minutes played. Offaly dug deep with Joe O'Connor, Keane Farrell and Rory McNamee from a tight angle here, reducing the gap to 2. With 5 minutes remaining, goalkeeper Paddy Dunican made it a 1 point game from a long range free. 2 Neil Flynn points followed, along with this from Paul Cribben to put Kildare 4 in front with time almost up. Flynn kicked the last point of the game, securing victory for Jack O'Connor's Kildare and a place in the Leinster semi-final against Meath. So full-time in Amora Park, Offaly 16 points, Kildare 20.
Marie Crow reporting there. The one story that kind of stood out for me there was Neil Flynn, who came on as a sub for Kildare today. His father was buried yesterday, and coming on today and scoring 3 points, you sense his father Fergal was looking down and looking after him there. So tough on him, and well done to him for getting playing today. Kildare Meads now in a Leinster semi-final. They're always tough, tight games, Kieran.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, you touched on it, Des. Neil Flynn was hugely influential in that last quarter. Awfully stayed with Kildare all day. They were on their coattails. They had brilliant performances. Keane Farrell, Anton Sullivan kicked some brilliant scores. But Kildare were just that bit better, you know what I mean? And I think kind of Jack O'Connor has probably found a couple of players like Sir Derek Irwin on the edge of the square, Kevin Feely in the middle of the park, Aaron Masterson played very well as well. So Kildare were always kind of in control of the game, but awfully stayed with them. I have to say, Kevin Feely for me, Des, is one of the best midfielders in the country in terms of feeling the ball. He's absolutely excellent, and his clean catches led to a lot of key Kildare scores. You see a great score there from Derek Irwin, but we've seen him do it against Dublin and Brian Fenton in Croke Park before. He's a handful.
Gives
them a platform, and I think there's the one aspect is there's with the winter weather, there's a lot more longer kickouts coming back into the game. We saw that across all the games this weekend. But his ability to feel the ball from different angles is fantastic. Derek Irwin, as I said, inside has been a brilliant find for them. But Kildare will be happy. You see a great score here.
But Meath have been playing at a higher level, have they, in Division One? Kieran?
Yeah, they have, and it makes for an intriguing game next week. There's Meath will be happy to have won today. They needed a victory. They just needed something. You've got a feel for Wicklow, who probably invested a lot of their energy and mental energy into the two games against Wexford. Meath controlled the game. It's set up for a good battle next week. Kildare probably have players that won't have that experience at Croke Park, where Meath played in the Super 8s last year. Have they benefited from that time in Division 1? So that's going to be a close one next week. It's very, very difficult to call.
And as usual, GAA Go and RT News Now will be showing matches next weekend, so you won't miss anything. Anyway, thank you very much for your company, gentlemen. Appreciate it. Coming next, though, we reflect on all the action from the hurling qualifiers with Ursula Jacob and Donal O'Cusick.
They travel from all four corners, a journey of thousands who become one.
As part of Science Week on RTE, Future Ireland is coming to you live over three nights. We'll be looking at how Ireland's brightest...